Family and friends, we come together today to celebrate the amazing life of Robert B. Ferguson. And as we do, I invite each of us into this holy space, willing to trust God, to hold our weary hearts, to keep our spirits grounded and steady, and to soothe our souls. Let us pray. Loving God, we thank you for the gift of life and for all those who are dear to us. Especially, we thank you for Bob Ferguson, whose life has blessed us in so many ways. We thank you for the gift of love, for the beauty of human relationships, and for all the love we knew from Bob. We thank you for the gift of hope and how our hope in you will always let us see the light when we find ourselves in the valley of darkness. And we thank you for the gift of peace and for how you always return us to our peace in our times of difficulty and loss. Be present with each of us here. Give us the courage, strength, and dignity we need to grieve so we can remember Bob with a peace that surpasses our human understanding. In the name of your Son, Jesus Christ, receive all our feelings and prayers. Amen. And now I would like to invite Bob's grandson, Eric Firth, to come forward and share our first scripture reading.
A reading from the book of Ecclesiastes. For everything, there is a season and a time for every matter under heaven, a time to be born and a time to die, a time to plant and a time to pluck up what is planted, a time to kill and a time to heal, a time to break down and a time to build up, a time to weep and a time to laugh, a time to mourn, and a time to dance. A time to throw away stones, and a time to gather stones together. A time to embrace, and a time to refrain from embracing. A time to seek, and a time to lose. A time to keep, and a time to throw away. A time to tear, and a time to sow. A time to keep silence, and a time to speak. A time to love and a time to hate, a time for war and a time for peace.
That old rug ragged cross, I will ever be true. Each shame and reproach gladly bear. Then he'll call me someday to my home far away, where his glory forever I'll share. So I'll cherish the old rugged cross till my trophies at last I lay down. I will cling to the old rugged cross and exchange it someday for a crown. And exchange it someday for a crown.
Thank you, Dr. Jim and Ken. For our time of remembering, I would like to call Bob's daughter, Lori Firth, to come forward and share a few memories with us.
Thank you for coming. Thank you for coming to help honor my father. It remains astonishing to me that he won't be here to enjoy being with his friends and family today. But I like to think that he is here among us and will be in our hearts forever. My dad was a loving, generous man. His beginnings were humble. He was born in the small town of Middlesboro, Kentucky, near the Cumberland Gap, to Nell and Robert Ferguson Sr., their only child. He lost his father to leukemia when he was only 18 months old. He was raised by a single mother in Charlotte, North Carolina. Life was not easy. Dad would often talk about the ways in which divine intervention would shape and change the trajectory of his life. He called it the hand of God, or H-O-G. It started when he graduated from high school. College was not in his sights, so he figured he'd get a job and work his way up. On a chance trip to the mountains to drop off a friend at a small junior college, he met a man that he knew there from the Baptist Church in Charlotte. The man asked what Dad's plans were and then offered him a work scholarship to attend Lees McRae Junior College. He jumped at the chance, and it changed everything for him. Once there, the hand of God intervened again. On Sadie Hawkins Day, which for those who don't know, it's where women can ask men out. This was the 1950s. Shirley Vickers, a fellow student at Lees McRae, who thought Bob Ferguson was a catch, literally ran after him that day, and the rest is family history. In a slideshow a little bit later, you'll see a photo of that very instance captured for all time. They dated until Dad's graduation, and then he entered the Army while my mom finished her studies. Suddenly called up for duty early, they arranged a quick wedding at the end of 1955 before he deployed to Frankfurt, Germany to work as a cryptographer. If you had ever heard his stories about that time, incredible. Mom joined him soon after. The GI Bill allowed my father to return to college, so Mom and Dad attended the University of North Carolina at Chapel Hill. And you all know how proud he was to be an alumnus of that school. Tar Heel Blue. Bob and Vicki welcomed my brothers David and Ken, and then me. And Dad began working in business and mortgage banking. Kept getting promoted because he was such a good worker. And we moved from North Carolina to St. Louis and then to Denver in the late 70s, just in time for the Orange Crush Denver Broncos era. Some special memories from my childhood that may mean nothing except to my brothers and me is my dad would wake us up singing the Howdy Doody song, except he changed the words to, "It's happy, happy get up time." And he would throw the lights on, rip the covers off, and sing at full volume. And so we do remember that. And I understand that some people still sing it today. Also, our road trip vacations. My dad loved cars. He was always driving everywhere. And so our family vacations were driving vacations. And it would begin with us children being woken up in our pajamas, grabbing a bed pillow, and going in the back of a station wagon at what we called the O'Dark 100. And then a few hours later, we would be woken up. He would pull to the side of the road, and we would get the incredible breakfast of chocolate milk and donuts at the side of the road. And that was many, many times. And then there was the time that he would find the steepest hill in a town. Usually it was after church, it seemed like. And he would hit the pedal, and we'd go flying down the hill, and he'd yell, "Roller coaster!" And my mom at the bottom of the hill would make the car jump, and we would all bounce in the back of the seat, and my mom would yell, "Ferg!" Dad thrived in Denver. He loved the city, and he made many friends here through work at the mortgage company, the Mortgage Bankers Association, his church, St. Andrews, and even model railroading aficionados that were his friends. He and my mom learned how to ski. And one favorite passion of my father, again, was cars. The faster, the better. The Porsche Club and its events and races held a special place in his heart for many years. Another transfer brought a move to Los Angeles. As the youngest, I followed them there after college graduation. LA was not a great match for my dad, and an early retirement brought him back to Denver to Highlands Ranch. It wasn't long before us kids were all married and off on our own, and when the first grandchild, Eric, came along, I called my parents to let them know we were going to the hospital. They got in the car, and they beat us home from the hospital, from Denver to Los Angeles, waiting in the driveway, like, "Give me the baby." They were elated. As a granddad, he took each of my sons on a special trip when they turned 12 years old. We enjoyed many happy holidays together and enjoyed time at his property in Paso Robles. And even on a South American excursion that took us all around the Cape Horn. And Dad became a caretaker too. He took care of my mother when she was diagnosed with breast cancer, and he did it all, and with so much love, it really taught me how to take care. And I needed that in this last month. After Mom passed, Dad ventured back to California to join my eldest brother and his wife, David and Ellen, in Paso Robles. They built adjacent homes on a beautiful hill, 40-acre lot, and enjoyed many shared meals and wine-tasting excursions there. Ever the traveler, he took Ken to Australia and New Zealand on a fantastic trip. He loved it so much, he took Dave and Ellen there again a few years later. The hand of God had one more important lesson in Dad's life. In October of 21, Dad developed pneumonia and was hospitalized. It was sudden. And in rehab, he was not too happy about his care. He came home with me in California, and with physical therapy and occupational therapy, he was restored to health. And it was then that he decided that he wanted to permanently move back to Colorado and ended up at Windcrest, the senior living community that ended up being his last address. And that's where he met Fern Bechtel, a special woman who meant very much to him. Thank you, Fern, for making his life so much better. When I think of a word to describe my dad, it was driven, literally and figuratively. He was always busy with work, car projects, helping other people, and traveling, always on the go. And that's why it's so hard to believe that this great traveler and perennial energizer bunny has left this earth. I imagine he's asking everyone in heaven, "What are y'all doing today?" My dad was wise counsel, sometimes whether you ask for it or not. But he was often right. and generous too with his time and money. How can I measure the life of a man who's been a part of the entirety of my own? Whom will I call for advice? But he's with me, and I encourage all of you to keep a piece of him with you today and ever. God bless you, Daddy. I'll miss you.
Thank you so much, Lori. And now I'd like to call Bob's son, David, forward to share memories.
I am very grateful that we're able to share this celebration of my father's life with his many friends, thanks to today's technology. I know we have friends watching the webcast from Florida to California and even New Zealand. Since some of his closest friends couldn't be here, I'm going to read some words that they wanted to share. The first is from my father's longtime friend, Bill Kernow, who recently moved from the area and is unable to attend in person. We are together to remember Bob Ferguson. However, we will all remember different things from having Bob in our life, as he gave each of us a different view of a dear soul and a great friend, father, and grandfather. My relationship with Bob really started with his wife, Vicki, a dear soul also. When at St. Luke's United Methodist, Vicki was in charge of the Advent calendar, book that was produced for the classes of children at Christmas. In that process, I became friends with Vicki as I did the printing for the church and was also part of the advisory board. The book that Vicki wrote and designed came to me in a wonderful format, not something that happened very often, as it was in Apple computer format and was very easy for me to work with. I was surprised, as at that time, Apple was not the go-to publishing platform that it later became. When questioned about it, Vicki shared with me that her husband was a Mac guy, as well as her son David, who worked at Apple. She suggested that during the production of the piece, if I needed changes or revision, I should contact her husband, Bob. Thus, the initial introduction was made, and we were off to the races, with many things in common and the beginning of a long-lasting friendship and love. Bob was not quick to share his stories with me during this early period. Rather, he would point to his children with pride and talk about their accomplishments. I started to find out that Bob had many personal accomplishments and interests in his own life, but they came out slowly and required a bit of prodding and time to get the blanks filled in. Bob was an only child and raised by his mother in tough times. They were very poor during the Great Depression. It is difficult for any of us in this room to fathom their struggles and hardships. Bob had his childhood friends, but they were few, as many adults did not opt to have kids during this period of struggle. And thus, he was one of the few kids in the rural area of North Carolina that he grew up. As an adult, Bob would step in to write something that needed attention or care and carry the burden himself. The various deeds never made the headline news, but rather would be taken in quiet stride, and the results would stay between himself and the friend that needed help. These acts went on for the entire period that I knew Bob. He never told of the actions until long after, and I would look with awe at this man that could step up and save a church, make music for many to hear, bring a clear voice to one that was damaged, throw a life preserver to one that was financially sinking, work to mend a soul that had personal tragedy, offer a hand up to a close friend that wanted to start a new business, support a hobby store in tough times. These were not just offers of help, but true life-altering acts done when others were not willing or able to step up. Now, all of these acts and many more have names associated, but they were not needed, as Bob would just give that great smile knowing that he had made things better and did not need any attaboys or medals that would be the motivation for other men. Bob's first and foremost loves were Vicki and his mother, who lived till nearly 103. Bob provided the love and care that the only son and living relative could provide. The death of both women within days of each other devastated Bob. It was many years before he was able to come to a peace, with the knowledge that he did everything he could in life and then in death to give dignity and comfort to these two women that had brought Bob from a child to the person we all knew. The next loves were the children and grandchildren that he would support in any way he could. Bob wanted to make them the best they could be. But there's a fine line between help and involvement that Bob worked very hard to stay on the right side of. As with all humans, it is easy to say, I should have done this. But rather than that, Bob stepped up and gave his wisdom, knowledge, and resources to his kids and grandkids, making them better equipped to take on the world that they live in. Bob was one to say that he is not a scholar, but just an ordinary student. Now, this may be what he believed of himself, but those of us that knew Bob knew that he was very well read and introspective, and he had views and knowledge on many, many subjects. After his first swing at college, he went into the service, Army intelligence, code work, and he worked in Europe with his wife at his side, who, it can now be said, worked for the newly formed CIA. When returning back to the States, he had the sobering realization that he now had a wife. Bob used the GI Bill and went on to complete the education that was not that important a few years earlier. Bob and Vicky worked hard, but enjoyed life during this period of time before kids and with relatively few obligations. It was then that they bought a blue 1957 two-door Chevy Bel Air, fully loaded. They started to travel on weekends and began living the American dream. It was told to me that one time Vicky was driving this hot rod on an errand of some sort, and she caught the eye of some guys in another car. It was a situation that required a solution, and that was speed. In working out the logistics of the situation, this was the Chevy, the heartbeat of America. Vicky knew she could and would outrun these characters, and thus the 120 mile per hour story evolved. Is it true? Who knows? But I think it started the genetic need for speed that the entire Ferguson family, except Lori, that lives on today. Between red Porsches, SCCA racing, Woody Creek raceways, and a stable of high-powered autos that are scattered among the Ferguson clan, there is no doubt of the early embracing of the fun in the fast lane for the Fergusons. Bob, on a professional level, was again successful, starting with a small mortgage company in North Carolina and moving up the ladder until he was leading mortgage companies first in St. Louis and then Denver. He was the president of the Colorado Mortgage Bankers Association and active with the Mortgage Bankers Association of America. He navigated the changing legislation of the industry and implemented many policies that helped folks purchase homes, the American dream come true. Back to the unpretentious statement of not being a great student, Bob a few years back set up a scholarship at Lees McRae College, not for the highest achievers, but for those that showed the most promise in making a difference in the lives of others. I am aware of at least five folks, probably more, that have benefited from this effort. Again, it is a testament of his willingness to step forward and do what needs to be done for the betterment of others. Now, Bob had his bad days, his fight with cancer, his immune system failure, his mystery disease that Lori nursed him back from a few years back. But in spite of these, he was always ready to take a trip, even driving practically nonstop across the entire country, to explore the world and share his experiences. Overall, he enjoyed a pretty darn good health until just short of the 90th birthday that we would have all celebrated in a month or so. All of this because of that pesky bloody nose that came back again and again. Now, maybe it was more than that, we'll never know. But we do know what a wonderful person we all had in our lives. The good news is that he is still in our lives by example, as well as the changes he made to all that he helped, certainly me being one of many. I will miss the working on our guns, the trips, the rides to the airport, the many meals shared, the stories told, the car discussions, and the discussions of things greater than me. And I will remember what was shared with me when my son Ryan died and Bob comforted me. It was said, we should not cry because it is over. We should smile because it happened. I will miss you, Bob, and I will always have you in my life. Bill Kernow. Okay, now these are words from Bob's friend and former pastor, Bill Selby. One might say that the relationship between Bob and me, two adult Christian males with sometimes diametrically opposing thoughts and opinions, while at the same time deeply loving one another, is at the heart of who St. Luke's United Methodist is and is all about. Me honoring Bob's conservative bent, and Bob honoring my progressive thinking. in the midst of disagreement, we could always end by saying something to the effect, though we disagreed, it is so good to know that we indeed love one another. Most of those times we affirmed that with a tear in our eyes. I loved Bob's teddy bear heart that he continued to grow into the older he got. I have wonderful memories of Bob and I and the MG Midget at an English car show in Glenwood Springs, driving over Independence Pass with the top down and snow much higher than the car. A tender highlight of our lives together was driving his yellow Porsche to Rocky Mountain National Park in 2006 and spreading some of Vicky's ashes, sharing stories and tears, and toasting their love with champagne. The first time I met Bob, I was probably in one of my most vulnerable moments as a person and as a pastor. He knew it and he honored it. In 1989, he is a representative of the Finance Committee of St. Andrew's United Methodist in Littleton at the time, and me, as a pastor of St. Luke's, were in an official gathering with others at the Rocky Mountain Conference headquarters, waiting to meet an officer of the Cherry Creek Bank to negotiate a loan to pay off the bonds of about $900,000, which were coming due soon, and ultimately addressing if St. Luke's was indeed going to remain open. After a couple of challenging, stressful years and a lot of work by a St. Luke's team to put together our proposal, we came together for that meeting. The phone rang in the room. It was answered by a conference staff person who then handed the phone to me because the person on the phone asked to speak to me directly. I picked it up and the voice on the other end said, "This is Cherry Creek Bank. We've decided not to come. We believe this is not a good loan for us. We wish you well," and hung up. I was not ready for that. I turned around quite shaken to report that I had just heard. I followed this up with saying, "I do church. I don't have the gifts to do loans." It was Bob who looked me in the eyes and said, "I don't believe them. I believe this is a good loan. Can I take it with me and work on it?" As we were bonded together, a very tender bonding. It was a few Sundays later that Bob and Vicky showed up at St. Luke's, proceeded to become active, and later became members. And Bob, well, Bob did indeed work on the loan proposal and was able to negotiate a loan for the congregation, and the rest, as they say, is history. However, there is another chapter to that historical episode that I promised Bob I would not share until after his death. On this detail, we also disagreed, by the way. It was about 7 years later after that loan was signed that I received in the mail from the bank all of the papers and records of that very loan negotiated by Bob. What I found in the fine print, though, is the rest of the story. In that report, it was quite clear that the loan came about not by the work of the church alone, but because Bob put up his own personal stock for enough collateral that the bank would agree to the loan. Now, some of you will remember that we as a church of St. Luke's, at the time of that loan signing, officially affirmed and recognized Bob for his hard work of rewriting and negotiating the loan by presenting him with the coveted Orion Award during worship time, which was a framed award that he hung proudly in his office with other diplomas and certificates of note. But the full reality of the gift of what Bob had done was not known at that time. Upon reading these newfound records and what Bob had done, I set up a time to meet with him and share what I had learned. He was deeply troubled, for the bank had given their word that his gift would always remain anonymous, and if not totally unknown. I share that story today because I believe it is who Bob was. And I know that there are other programs and people who benefited from Bob's clandestine gifts, some of whom I know, but others that we will never know. But it is time, Bob, that I told the secret. As I said before, I dearly loved Bob's teddy bear heart and the legacy he leaves, both known and unknown. His life, his gifts live on. We are all blessed. And I will greatly miss our conversations and the tears we shared and the love that bonded our hearts together. It is said that those Methodists that gathered at the beginning of our denomination over 200 years ago, that people would say about them, "See how they love one another?" Honoring Bob's legacy is to continue that sacred process. I love you, Bob. Blessings to you and your many gifts. I miss you, Bill.
Thank you, David. We each have our own memories of Bob, and you are invited to share your memories with the family at the gathering following the service. For now, I invite you to remember Bob through these special pictures of our slideshow.
Thank you.
blessed assurance, Jesus is mine. Oh, what a foretaste of glory divine, heir of salvation, purchase of God, born of his Spirit, washed in his blood. This is my story, this is my song, praising my Savior all the day long. This is my story, this is my song, praising my Savior all the day long. Perfect submission, perfect delight, visions of rapture now burst on my sight. Angels descending bring from above echoes of mercy, whispers of love. This is my story, this is my song, praising my Savior all the day long. This is my story, this is my song, praising my Savior all the day long. Perfect submission, all is at rest. I and my Savior am happy and blessed. Watching and waiting, looking above, filled with his goodness, lost in his love. This is my story, this is my song, praising my Savior all the day long. This is my story, this is my song, praising my Savior all the day.
Thank you, Jim and Ken. And now I invite you to bring your heart in closer to hear these words from the Gospel of John. This is chapter 4, verses 46 through 54. Jesus returned to Cana in Galilee, where he had turned the water into wine. In Capernaum, there was a certain royal official whose son was sick. When he heard that Jesus was coming from Judea to Galilee, he went out to meet him and asked Jesus if he would come and heal his son, for his son was about to die. Jesus said to him, "Unless you see miraculous signs and wonders, you won't believe." The royal official said to him, "Lord, come before my son dies." Jesus replied, "Go home. Your son lives." The man believed the word that Jesus spoke to him and set out for his home. While he was on his way, his servants were already coming to meet him. They said, "Your son lives." So he asked them at what time his son started to get better. They said, "The fever left him yesterday, about 2 p.m. Then the father realized that this was the hour when Jesus said to him, "Your son lives." And he, and his entire household believed in Jesus. This was the second miraculous sign Jesus did while going from Judea to Galilee. Here ends the reading. Thanks be to God. There's a season for everything and a time for every matter under the heavens. And on June 1st, 1934, in Middlesboro, Kentucky, the world was blessed when Bob was born. For Bob was a reliable, committed, generous, and thoughtful human being in this world. And I'm sure each of you have a story that David could have read about how Bob's reliability, commitment, generosity, or thoughtfulness impacted you. But I want to share how all of these things impacted St. Luke's, and I hope it captures the same feelings of your experience with Bob. Back in the mid-1980s and in the late 1980s, when St. Luke's was still coming into being, as we heard from Bob Selby's Telling a Secret, Bob was right there making it happen. How did Bob help you make something happen in your life? Because when it was not looking like St. Luke's was going to come to fruition, Bob stepped up with a generous heart and with generous giving, because he believed in this community and was committed to making sure the love that was in this place got to come to fruition. We now know the fullness of what he did to make that happen. He believed in St. Luke's. How did Bob believe in you? And how did his belief in you allow your love and your life to grow and to come to fruition? Because this was not just a one-time moment of commitment and generosity for Bob. Bob was always showing up and helping out. He was so reliable in that way, because when Dr. Dim had to have surgery on his vocal cords at an out-of-state hospital that specialized in this type of surgery, Reverend Janet Forbes, the pastor at the time here at St. Luke's, planned a fundraiser to help pay for this expensive and specialized surgery for Jim. And in the love of St. Luke's, people donated and supported and prayed and raised that money. And then there was Bob. Bob did all of those things, but he took it to the next level. And he donated all of the money to cover all of the expenses that it took St. Luke's so that we could begin the Center for Spiritual Engagement that exists here at St. Luke's, the Center for Spiritual Engagement that recognizes that not all people meet God in worship, but out in nature or in a different class or in different ways. And they can engage and meet God that way. Bob planted that seed money for that to happen. How did Bob go above and beyond for you? How did he love and support you and plant seeds in you? I have one more example of Bob's reliability, commitment, generosity, and thoughtfulness. And it's sitting right over there. That Baldwin piano was given to St. Luke's by Bob in dedication of his mother, Nell. It was a precious gift and one that has blessed this community for almost 30 years. What precious gift have you been blessed with because of Bob? Was it an item, a conversation, a feeling? What precious gift have you been blessed with because of Bob? because Bob has blessed us in so many ways. And through it all, as Bob reflected on the things that happened in his life, he saw, and what he called it, the HOG, what Lori talked about, the hand of God. Bob saw the hand of God working miraculous signs and wonders in his life, throughout his life. So many times, like the father whose son was sick in the scripture I just read, Bob realized it was God who had a hand in how things worked out. Because even in difficult times, Bob knew things would work out and that he'd be okay, even if it took years, because he knew the hand of God was working in the world. Bob was like the father in this scripture story. He believed. Jesus said, unless you see miraculous signs and wonders, you won't believe. And that father in the story turned around and went home without Jesus, trusting and believing that his son would be okay. He believed, and so he saw. He saw the hand of God working in the world. Bob saw the hand of God working in his life and all over the place. And Bob extended his hands so others could know the hand of God in their lives too, through his generous and loving acts. How did Bob extend his hand to you? Was it a hand of love? A hand of generosity? A hand of thoughtfulness? A hand of reliability? Of commitment? However Bob extended his hand to you, know his spirit will continue to be extended to you. For the spirit never dies. It lives on. That's the beauty of Jesus' generous gift. The body may perish, but the soul lives forever, eternally. So how will Bob's spirit be with you now? How will you feel his presence with you now? How will his spirit lend you a hand now? Because it will. Maybe you will sense Bob's spirit when you travel, because he loved to travel. Maybe you'll sense him when you hear or see a train go by, because he loved trains. Or maybe you'll sense him when you lend a hand to others. Because that is how we can honor Bob's life. We can keep the hand of God alive in this world through our hands, through how we are reliable, committed, generous, and thoughtful. That's the best way to ensure Bob's gifts will keep on giving. It's through the example he gave us. So look for how Bob's spirit will be present in your life now. Look for it. Expect it. Because he set us up well. And now that he is resting in God's hands in heaven, we can be the ones to make sure the hand of God is still seen in this world. For the world needs it. We need it. So let's bring it and show it and keep Bob's blessings going. May it be so. Amen.
Before I sing this song, I just want to share, and the family knows this, that the songs that were chosen today were some of Bob and Vicky's favorites, and some of you were the 8 o'clockers from way back when we used to have the hymn sing. they made sure that we sang those three songs. That's why we're singing these songs. And I also want to share that on the Saturday before Easter, Amazing Grace was the last song that Bob sang. He sang about a half of the second verse, and Lori was there, and Kenny was there as well. Amazing grace, how sweet the sound that saved a wretch like me. I once was lost, but now am found, was blind, but now I see. T'was grace that taught my heart to fear, and grace my fears relieved. How precious did that grace appear the hour I first believed. Through many dangers, toils, and snares, I have already come. 'Tis grace hath brought me safe thus far, and grace will lead me home. The Lord has promised good to me, His word my hope secures. He will my shield and portion be, as long as life endures. When we years, bright shining as the sun, we've no less days to sing God's praise than when we first be.
Thank the Ferguson family. That was money well spent. Jim, thank you. Will you join me in prayer? Compassionate and calming God, today we celebrate the life and love of Bob Ferguson. Thank you for his presence in our lives and for receiving him into your loving presence. Hold us in that same love now so we can know we are completely free and safe to feel everything we are feeling. hold our hearts so close so we can know without a doubt that we will be okay, that we are not alone, that we will always have a connection to Bob's spirit, and that we will go on with confidence and grace. For life is good, and our lives will continue to be good because we have you as our steady strength and reliable hope that never leaves us in a bad place, but always brings us back around to our inner peace. In the name of your Son, Jesus Christ, receive our thanks and love. Amen. The family invites you to gather with them following this service for some light refreshments right outside those doors. The family will walk out first, and then you are welcome to join us. And now may the road rise up to meet you. May the wind be always at your back. May the sun shine warm upon your face and the rains fall soft upon your fields. And until we meet Bob again, may God hold you in the palm of his hand. Amen.